First of all, hi, very good evening to all of you. Hope you're keeping safe. Thank you for inviting me. I always love interacting with young students and young people. I know there are lots of speakers over here, so I'm gonna try and be quick. So on this topic, unrealistic body standards, I think what I can do is that I can bring in my own perspective as a feminist, as an educator, also as a woman, millennial. I would say most of you probably here are Gen Z. So maybe also maybe bring in a perspective of someone who was born in the 90s and how, you know, So that's what I'm here to do. So when I look at the topic, unrealistic body standards, it kind of makes me wonder if there are realistic body standards, you know, like, achha, ye realistic hai, ye kar sakte hain. All right. Now the question is, the first thing that comes to my mind is, why do we need to have standards at all, right? Why can't we celebrate uniqueness? Why should we? So when we talk about standards, there's something, a term in psychology that we call ideal body image. All right, so ideal body image are these pictures, you can say a visual image, a description of what is a beautiful man or what does a beautiful woman look like. And every society kind of shares that, those views. And these messages of what the standard, beauty standard is, are kind of transmitted through socialization, they're transmitted through mass media, etc. So if I look at, ideal body image, yes, there are descriptions for what a beautiful woman looks like and what a beautiful man looks like. Of course, there are. So if I start with beautiful women, of course, if I ask my students, okay, what is the ideal body image? So, and I've asked this question many times. So they'd give me something like tall girl, straight, long, silky hair, something that I, you know, very skinny, fair, of course. And something that I recently heard very funny was high cheekbones. I was like, okay, this is new to the list, high cheekbones, right? This is something that we called the Aphrodite complex, you know, Greek goddess, looking like a Greek goddess is what is the standard that we hold. Similarly, if you look at men, there are of course messages given to men also and boys also about what is, you know, and I think India mein hum log apne time pe at least bolte aaye hain ki Hrithik Roshan type of a person, again like a Greek god. So you're talking about muscular guy, you're talking about a tall guy, you're talking about I guess a certain kind of facial features, etc. And that's what we call the Adonis complex, which is the Greek male god complex. There was this research that I want to point out here, which I did with my students, where I, we talked about ideal body image and examined ideal body and real body image, what you are right now, and what you'd like to be. And this was strictly on the basis of, you know, physical structure, like your body weight, etc. And it was found that most girls wanted to lose weight. They wanted to get skinnier. They wanted to get thinner. But the boys also were not very happy with their the way they looked. So, but the direction in which the boys wanted their weight to move, and we're talking about young adults, which is about, I think we assessed 18 to 22 year old boys, the boys wanted to gain weight. And by gain weight, it basically meant musculature, that they wanted to put on muscles. So what we found out was that body dissatisfaction in this kind of sample, we didn't find any gender difference. We had hypothesized that, you know, girls are going to probably experience more body dissatisfaction than do boys, but that really wasn't the case. However, the direction in which they were dissatisfied was different. So, which is not surprising given the fact that, the beauty industry is a multi-dollar industry, right? So they have been preying upon women's insecurity since a very, very long time. You know, I've read this quote somewhere and I really, really believe, you know, that if women start becoming, you know, they start gaining self-esteem, bodily self-esteem, a lot of industries would run out. You know, your fairness industry, your sauna belt industry, your dieting and your fashion and your makeup and everything kind of comes down to, we can make you look better. We can make him bring you closer to that ideal image if you pay us whatever amount of money. And we are ready to do that. We are ready to lap it up. Having said that, let me also make it very clear that I have no issue. They have no problem with makeup. I have no problem with, you know, clothing, etc. I think it's a kind of an art form. But when makeup and, clothing are driven by not celebrating our bodies, but by, self-loathing, underlying need is the anxiety, it's coming from an anxiety and not from a secure space. I think that's what I'm talking about. So definitely men as well as women have been, at least the young adult population, have been experiencing body dissatisfaction and lack of body appreciation, etc. since some time. Or agar aap dekhoge, so the industry has kind of expanded on to include men also. So we used to always have these fairness creams for women, you know, Fair and Lovely. And then we, again, there would be this sexism or misogyny happening where you're like, tu ladki hai jo tu fairness cream use kar raha hai. So suddenly the market came up with Fair and Lovely for men. And it was called Dark and Handsome or something like that, with Shah Rukh Khan being its brand ambassador. So what I wanted to point out over here is that definitely beauty standards is, you know, there is a lot of money behind the beauty industry. And we need to kind of realize that our mental health, somebody is profiting from our mental health. Now, this goes for boys and this goes for girls also. Right. Another thing that I wanted to point out, since I already talked about
Ma'am, you're beautiful.
I didn't do that, but okay. So I think another thing that I wanted to point out here was, again, coming out of my own research. So while I was, a couple of years ago, while I was researching body image, etc., what I realized is that there is a difference between the work in eating disorders that has been done in the West, or body dissatisfaction that has been done in the West, you know, anorexia and bulimia, nervosa, etc. In India, not only are some of us, especially the, you know, the young girls who've been exposed to the Western, if you see, and this has been a change that, you know, has been there, that a lot of the all developing countries, hamare yahan khate peete khandan ki, if you're plump, it used to be khate peete khandan ki. My own grandmother, if we lose weight, would go like, are tu kuch kha nahi rahi hai, tu bimar ho jayegi. We come from that culture where being overweight or plump was a sign of prosperity, ki aapke paas itna paisa hai ki khanda nahi rahi hai bhai, ki itna paisa hai ki hum mote hain, right? And being skinny or sickly thin was something that you would associate with poverty, right? But when we over, and the evidence, if you can see, is that in the 80s and 70s, all your heroes and heroines, your Rajesh Khanna, your Rekha, Jaya Bhaduri, etc., they were not how we see actors and actresses right now, with six-pack abs and with, you know, extremely thin, extremely skinny. They were voluptuous, if I can say, both men as well as women. But of course, then there was this whole trend in early 2000s, some of you would probably be just born then, with Kareena Kapoor bringing the size zero in from the West, which was Victoria Beckham size zero, and then it got caught on, etc. But yes, you can see the waist size of you know, actresses has gotten has reduced, and of course the six-pack ab phenomena has already been there in Bollywood since a very, very I would say since some time now. So there is also a study that found that in Fiji, before the advent of television, before television came in Fiji, the study has been done in Fiji Islands, and in the early 80s, before television came, the ideal body image was supposed to be of someone who's, you know, voluptuous, right? But they realized that after the advent of television, which was the westernization of beauty idols that we talk about, that West mein jaise, I heard someone mention Kylie Jenner, and I'm really not sure about who are the young role models right now, especially from the West. But now what started happening was that the entire world is homogenizing its beauty standards based on what the Western media presents to us, right? So extremely skinny and fair and skinny is what we get. And this is what we saw, that there's been cultural change in Fiji Island, of course, a case study that was published, but in our country also, where while we've all grown up with, you know, liking voluptuous, if you look at Ajanta Ellora, the kind of paintings that we have is very different from what, you know, we see in movies and TV today, right? So so I was actually talking about, this is something that of course is a cultural, you know, difference as and etc. I wanted to point that out. But what I also realized was that not only are Indian women I would say suffering from, I can use the word, from the fact that they're not extremely skinny and thin, but also most of us are also very insecure about a skin color, And this is something that you will not find in studies in the West, because skin color is not really an issue over there in that sense. So yahan pe hamare yahan kali hai, dhoop mein mat khel, aur you know, shaadi kaun karega. So there's so many women have spent so much money, time and energy in trying to lighten their skin color, and we haven't actually, so could there actually, we don't have a name for this disorder, of course, because most of our disorders are of coming from the DSM, Diagnostic Statistical Manual, published in America. So but this is there that if you look at, lots and lots of girls have been distressed because they're not fair enough, and they've constantly been taunted, not only because of their body weight but also because of the skin color. That is why when you had you know, so many women like many models, you would say, jo India mein jiski koi value nahi thi because they were not fair enough. You'd see someone like Padma Lakshmi going to West and they were treated as very beautiful and exotic. So if you're dark, even sometimes you'll hear things like, "Arey, bahut sundar hai, lekin agar rang thoda sa fair hota to better rehta." So yeah, over a period of time, this I wanted to bring up about skin color also, when you're talking about, I don't know if someone's discussed this or not, unrealistic beauty ideals. And then of course, over a period of time, I have been seeing with my own students, what is, you can say, there are all these social media driven trends. And of course, we need to spend some amount of time. Social media has given Gen Z a lot, and I'm not really the kind of millennial or an elderly or a teacher who's gonna say "Pagar diya bachcho ko" and all of that stuff. I do believe that social media has opened so much of information, has given so much of information for young adults that I wish we had gotten. We didn't. So let's say, for instance, people, just an example, that from my own age group, the members of the LGBT community, they always felt abnormal because they didn't know that there is a community out there, and which is what I believe Gen Z has got through social media. They have got a safe space which they weren't getting in the real world. So I'm not gonna just say that social media is all bad and this is the root of all evil, etc., but I'm definitely going to talk about how the fact that pehle we had to look up to actresses, you know, we would look up to, acha ye actress hai, iski tarah banna hai, ye model hai, iski tarah banna hai. Now my classmate looks like a damn model, and I feel sad about that because I have competitors all around me. The social comparison has increased, I can't even say tenfold, like anything. So if she can look like that, why can't I? And then I'm spending all the more time in self-loathing and feeling not good enough. At least I could say that actress, uska to job hai ye karne ka. She's like me. She has to study the same amount of time. Wohi same exam de rahi hai. Utna hi uski mummy papa bhi aise honge probably. And how does she get to look like that? So that's what social media has done. That it has vastly increased social comparison. And social comparison is what really drives the distress that comes from not looking a certain way. So that is one thing that, and then of course there are all these weird kind of challenges that I keep asking my students, because I frankly don't really get to know, is something like, jo abhi aapke liye purana ho chuka hai, mere liye kafi naya, thigh gap challenge. You know, you need to have thigh gap a certain way. You need to have a thigh gap. And I would always wonder that you'd probably all look like SpongeBob SquarePants with thigh gaps. So, uske alawa bhi kuch shoulder ka aaya tha, shoulder blades kuch aise hone chahiye, kuch cheekbones, I don't know what. But I also want to bring in the thing over here that, you know, a lot of people would say, ki acha ye woman ki problem nahi hai, unrealistic body standards, not a feminist issue. It's something that boys also feel and girls also feel. I disagree. I really, really disagree. I do feel till date, across the world, India mein, bahar bhi, women are more harshly judged for not looking a certain way than are men. And you really need to enter arranged marriage market to know that. Which a lot of my friends are, you know, right now, late 20s, early 30s, they're all, if not all, but most of them are on Shaadi.com, on Jeevan Saathi, and they get to know. So, ki ladki kali hai, you could be IIT and you could be IIM, you could be earning like how, but at the end of the day, women are really judged ki sundar honi chahiye, chushil honi chahiye, good looking honi chahiye, gori chitti honi chahiye, whereas men, body weight, looks doesn't matter. Unfortunately, men are, of course, also judged, but they're judged on how settled he is, what his package is, what his career is. So women, career is okay, but looks, beauty. So there have been very embarrassing things that humiliating, I wouldn't even call that embarrassing, humiliating things that some of my very educated, strong friends have gone through, where they've met a potential groom and the family, where they've asked her to step down and remove her heels in a 5-star hotel to show exactly how tall she is. Can you expect a man, can you expect any person to be doing that to a man, right? So, is tarike se, I think there are numerous examples where some of my friends who've been in this market for at least, and I would call it market, arranged marriage market, for 3 years, 4 years, and if they're not careful, their self-esteem takes such a huge beating because of how much they're judged. There've been places where someone has been asked, ki vaccine kitni baar karate ho? Mahine mein kitni baar karate ho? You know? And that's why I say, and if you look at your own parents, I don't know how many fathers are upset that they have a beer belly, but mothers, 40s, 50s are constantly like, weight gain ho gaya, yaar, weight gain ho gaya, weight gain ho gaya. So there is so much of, even for women, looking a certain way comes with so much of pressure that starts from as early as class one, maybe before, where you're like, mummy, main moti ho gayi hun. You heard very young girls talk about their, you know, their bodies, and it goes on till the time you die. And I would give you some examples. Like, for instance, a very sad example that, you know, always comes to my mind is that there was this one woman, late 50s, who got diagnosed with breast cancer. And she was advised mastectomy, that the cancer would spread. She has to remove her breast. But she didn't. She didn't, because she could not imagine what she would look like without a breast. And she died because of cancer. So this is the pressure that no man, I do not think this is the kind of intensity of pressure a man actually goes through. Similarly, there's this one girl in my class, very, a very smart kid. And we went on a trip. And for the first time, I realized she actually wears contact lenses, because never have I seen her wearing specs. And so she said, no, ma'am, I don't wear contact lenses. And I was like, okay, sorry, I do have a, you know, I do wear specs, etc. So I was like, where are your specs then? We were in a train and raat ho gayi thi, etc. And specs kyun nahi pehen rahe fir tum? I said, ma'am, I don't own a pair of spectacles. And I said, what do you do then? And I'm someone who's been wearing contact lenses since 11 years. I know how dry my eyes get if I'm ready to kind of remove my lenses and put on my spectacles. And like, what do you do then? She's like, nothing, ma'am, main so ke uthti hu, main lenses laga leti hu, main sone se pehle lenses utar deti hu. And my eyes literally pained when I heard that. Why? Because ma'am, mere chehre pe suit nahi karta spectacles. Similarly, there was this another girl who I was, going for swimming, and this girl would, you know, I would find many girls who would come to gym all dressed up, makeup on, fine, swimming. So you have your full makeup on for swimming, and I'm not judging the girl. I have full empathy for the girl, because nobody told her that she can get off that pressure of having to look a certain way sometimes in her life. उसको सुबह उठते ही मेकअप लगा देना और सोने से पहले मेकअप रिमूव करना, कोई भी ना देखे मुझे, हाउ डू आई एक्चुअली लुक, दैट्स सो सैड, दैट इज सो वेरी सैड. सो या आई हैव हर्ड दिस कोट समवेयर दैट आई काइंड ऑफ वुड लाइक टू रीइटरेट ओवर हियर, इज दैट टेलिंग ऑल यंग गर्ल्स आउट देयर दैट लुकिंग गुड इज नॉट द रेंट दैट यू पे टू एग्जिस्ट ऑन दिस प्लैनेट. यू व्हेन यू से यू लुक गुड एंड ड्रेस, यू नो, यू ड्रेस अप, इट डेफिनेटली, व्हेन यू से इट नीड्स टू बी फॉर योरसेल्फ, इट नीड्स टू बी फॉर योरसेल्फ. So you go back and you really think about this line, who do you dress up for? Who do you look good for? The unrealistic standards that you have in your head or yourself, you cannot fake to the person in the mirror. You don't have anyone else to answer to. So lastly, very quickly, what do we do then? I started with beauty standards. I think I would end it with the fact that I think beauty needs to be redefined. I have seen so many conventionally good looking people are horrible human beings. And I've seen so many conventional, non-conventional, what you wouldn't call as a sundar hai, ladka ladki dono, who are such wonderful human beings. So our standards of evaluating people, valuing people, should be based on the kind of human beings that they are. Kindness, especially kindness. I don't think in today's world I can emphasize how much of kindness we need. So a kind human being, I would say, is a beautiful human being for me. And that's where I'd like to end my two bits on this topic. You know, all gynecs would almost tell you that that vagina can clean itself. It doesn't need the what comes in the market to clean your vaginas, etc. Again, a way of making money out of telling you that, oh, somehow your vagina doesn't smell nice and you should use this and etc. In fact, they tell you to not wash your vagina with soap or anything. It's a self-cleaning mechanism, of course. Secondly, another thing that I'll probably just leave you guys with, the hymen reconstruction surgery that has been again in fashion for the last, I think, 7-8 years, where a lot of women are reconstructing the hymen. Some of them are doing it because, of course, they may have had premarital sex and they're going to be shamed after that. Oh, how did you have premarital sex? So reconstruct the hymen. I also read silly things like, my next year is going to be 25th marriage anniversary of me and my husband, so I want to gift him my hymen. I'm like, if your husband who's married for 25 years, probably 50 years old now, is looking at women with hymens, you have more things to worry about. So yeah, some of these things. I guess there are more speakers in line. Thank you so much for this, inviting me over here, and all the best to all of you. Take care.